Hodge, game two felt a lot like last season. How are you feeling?
Same old bath.
Guess who just got back today? Them wild-eyed boys that had been away. Haven't changed, had much to say. But man, I still think them cats are crazy. They were asking if you were around, how you was, where you could be found. I told them you were living downtown, driving all the old men crazy.
All right, guys, welcome to the 1865 Guys Bathrobe Vlogcast. That was a mouthful. On tonight's show, we're going to talk about the game itself. Unfortunately, we're there. The ref, injuries, always injuries, and Bath's drop in attendance. And then we'll get to the preview for the Wasps Friday night game. But first, oh, hand raised. Go ahead, Jamie.
Are there any good points to talk about tonight?
I don't know. That's an interesting segue to what was actually going to happen organically. So let me go through this very quickly as I see it, because we actually were at the game, could watch. It was not radio. There was commentators. In fact, Rory McConaughey was actually the guest commentator.
He does that quite a lot as well. Actually.
He's actually pretty good too.
Yeah, he is.
Okay, so as I saw it, and we'll give this recap very quickly so Hodge can give me his opinions of the game. Very quickly, two penalties in under 200 seconds of playing led to a quick try. Essentially, then a penalty led to a kick, and very quickly, 10-3. We basically couldn't get anything going. There was a Luke James 50-22, which was a hell of a kick. We never got closer than 10-6, the result of a red card, and all of a sudden down to 14 men. A botched kickoff, outstanding try for Sale again, 17-6. In my conclusion, just bad, bad rugby. Hodge, what stuck out to you the most from Saturday?
Well, unfortunately, guys and girls out there listening, the Thatchers took hold of me. I got a little bit too excited, so I don't actually remember seeing the game. But what I've read on the Facebook comments, I didn't really miss much. So actually, I think it's quite good that I don't remember it. Obviously, gutted with the loss. First game at home, you want to get that win in the bag. What I've read of the Facebook comments and what you've told me, mate, it was utter dross. Utter dross, and begs the question, what's going on?
Yeah, very depressing result. I was also drinking with you, but I do remember the game. Although not that it's actually worth remembering. In summation, because we can kind of go through this at certain points, but basically, Sale very smartly took advantage of every advantage that we gave them through penalties and miscues. So when we made an error, it wasn't, they took the points. They took the points or they made the plays and they scored the tries. And so when I look back there, it's very hard to be, I don't want to say upset. I walk away impressed with Sale and very unimpressed with Bath. And one of the biggest things that there was a stat that was shown immediately after the first half. It might have been around the 50 minute mark, but it was basically showing that at that point when the stat was shown, which I can't remember the exact time, Bath had 4 entries into the Sale 22 and came away with 7 points. At the same time, Sale had 6 entries into our 22 and came away with 24 points. And so what I saw there was, every time we made a mistake, Sale made us pay with points on the board. And what's scary to me now is we're trending, like we said, how we were last season. And what I go to immediately is, if you recall last season, Hodge, last season we have a 1-point loss at Sale. We take a bonus point. Everyone goes right on the road. First game, loss, but got a point. We come home. Newcastle jumps out 20-3 at the half, right? We're down 17, which is the, I believe, exact same points per town this time, 23-6 at the half. To a Sale team minus a player, we never recover. We didn't even get a point. So technically, through two games this season, we are worse than we were last season, which is the worst season in Bath rugby history. So this, we're going to get to the Wasps preview, but this is not a good sign. We were not good offensively, and we were not good defensively.
I think, coming from what you just said, Dan, this is the difference between the two teams. Sale, who are obviously now well coached, they've got game management, they know exactly what they're doing. These are the two words that are good. They keep cropping up across the terraces as well as game management. We just look lost, as if we don't know what we're doing. Now, I don't know whether the players are just being told to stick to the game plan, or none of them have got the balls to maybe try something different and change it up a bit. I mean, it didn't help with Ben Spencer going off, the talisman, our captain, and things seem to go a bit to pot when he's not there. But someone else then needs to, who's like the number two, needs to step up and be like, right, this is what we've got to do. We need to change this. Especially when you've got a two-man advantage. Why are you not utilising that?
Or more importantly, it took a two-man advantage for us to score 7 points, in which they were actually down a player for 70 minutes and outscored us 30-20.
Yeah.
So that's just, that cannot happen. So I walk away from the game saying a couple things. One, this is another scary stat for you. Bath actually led the league last year in missed tackles. Surprise, surprise. Through the first week last week, Bath led the league in missed tackles. So that's a troubling stat. The only bright spot in all of it was we need to, at least I would believe, we need to find a way to get Will Muir the ball about 10 times a game.
Horse.
Yep. And we need, again, it seems to me we have so many problems, I'm not even sure where you go to find the solution. So, I'm sure a lot of Bath fans are terrified for Friday night, which we'll get to.
It's two games in. We've gone from Bristol where, you know, everyone's like, things are looking good, things have changed, then back down to earth with a bang. Now, it is only two games in, granted, but it seems that the same old problems are creeping in. We know this is going to be a journey. Yep, we know that. But we want to see a little bit more hard work out on the pitch, surely, as us fans. We definitely deserve that. JVG has said that this is going to be a journey. There's going to be players getting on, there's going to be players getting off. I believe there'll be a lot of players getting off, and he'll be bringing a lot of his players in. Please not all South African though. Got to keep the balance. But there will be, yeah. It's a journey.
That's the bell. Next. Yep. Next topic. We do need to discuss, because in the post-game conference with JBG, the referee was brought up. The referee, let me make sure this is correct, was Christoph Ridley.
Correct.
Christoph Ridley was receiving some criticism, at least within some of the Bath fans, because, and I want to get this completely accurate because I actually rewatched the match on video so that I don't miss things from the game, but Christoph Ridley, this starts at the 56 and a half minute mark. Pierce Francis kicks to the corner. There was a line out. We take the line out. There's then a penalty advantage given. So that's the first penalty. There are then 5 successive scrum penalties called on Sale. After the 4th, there is a yellow card issued for Sale, but at no point was a penalty try awarded, and Sale salted away. Now, by the way, I give them credit because there must have been some awareness and conversation on the Sale team that they were never warned of a penalty try, or there was no mention of a penalty try, but they managed to salt away over 10 minutes of game time.
Game management.
And so that is a devastating blow for a team trying to come back, and I can't imagine, because it ended in a Bath turnover, and that was, in my opinion, probably the last gasp for the game. So, Hodge, should Christoph Ridley be receiving some criticism for perhaps his under-reffing in this situation?
Well, again, it was all down the far end of the pitch, so I don't really remember seeing much of that. But, yeah, question is always going to be asked of the referee, but it's a bit like, you know, you're asking the coach what their thoughts are, they've got to be very careful what they say in terms of criticising. I mean, we can, obviously, and if I watched the game more, I could criticise them. But yeah, I don't know. It's poor for me today, I know, because I just really can't remember seeing much of the game.
So
this bad, I'm sorry.
Yeah, but no,
it's not much of a vlog class, is it? I remember seeing the game.
You don't have to apologize for it. It's going to happen to all of us, at least I imagine at some point. But what I would say is, from my limited experience watching rugby, after the third scrum half is usually when, at least that's what I can recall, when the penalty comes, right? Usually it's one, two's the warning, third's the, that's where it's going to go, right? Didn't take three, four. Four was the yellow, and then after five, still no penalty try. So again, I somewhat, you know, this is one of those things we have to know the ref, but I'll be very interested to watch him go forward this season, if we can remember to do so, about how he manages scrum penalties, because that was beautiful by Sale. Right, they didn't give up a single point for 10 minutes. So a fourth of the second half, they salted away, doing nothing. Right, catching their breath, standing up over and over, and whatever the ref told them, obviously didn't in any way affect their behavior in terms of being willing to risk getting a penalty. And so brilliant on them, but I think that was bad on Christoph Ridley, because to me, if he calls that, you know, two penalties earlier with the yellow, there's more time on the clock, and there's 13 players then. And so, to me, again, I'm not a fan of over-reffing. I think this was a very unique case of under-reffing what seems to be pretty established.
Yeah, I think I'm pretty sure that referees, their games were reviewed by head of referees, so they'll probably obviously take note and put them aside and say. But if any of you wiser old heads out there who may be ex-props and know the dark arts of the scrum, please feel free to put a comment at the bottom, and maybe you can help explain to us the situation why it didn't happen.
I would love an explanation as to how you get five penalties deep without a penalty try. That is a mystery to me. And more importantly, let's just go from the fan perspective, right? That was boring. It's boring on video, and it's boring at the game. It's just 10 minutes, right? That is 10 minutes of an 80-minute game spent far away from a lot of spectators, and everyone's just kind of going, whistle, okay, line up again, whistle, okay, line up again, whistle, line up again, whistle, okay, gets a yellow card, great, we cheer, and then whistle, and then it's just, that was just an incredible amount, like a waste of time. That's not good product, in my opinion.
I heard that the backs were bored and cold. Give them the ball.
The next topic is very interesting to me. And Hodge, I'm not even sure you know this yet, but it was actually written, Somerset Live. So Bath sold out its season tickets very quickly, which is impressive given the season that we had last year. However...
But did they?
Well, they did, but on Saturday, 3,000 empty seats at Bath. Now the question is the fan mentality changing at Bath that is going to lead to less people in the stands?
I'll jump in with a couple of things. Again, it's from comments that I've read on Facebook that you'd probably have to go back, I don't know, five seasons and just look at the stats in terms of first game attendances. And in fact, actually, I think that Tom Dabbs, has put something up on the Facebook supporters group about that. I think statistically, we always have fewer attendances in September and it picks up again in October. I'm not sure if that's people coming back from being away, but that's what's floated around on there. So it might be, you know, it might be looking at something. I know a lot of people who didn't renew their season tickets, but apparently we sold out again. But yeah, I mean, and also, what I think is a good point as well, is a Category 1 ticket for Bath Rugby for the big games, it's like 70 quid. Between 60 and 70 quid for a ticket. Who's going to want to pay that?
I did not know. We're season ticket holders, so I'm a little bit blind to the actual game.
So in a different category.
Yeah, to the actual cost of the...
In the covered stand is 70 quid for a single game. Why are you going to pay that?
Well, what I find interesting is a couple of things. One, 3,000 is a significant number, right? The rec holds about 15,000. Let's just go with that. So that's 20% of the stadium is empty. For the first home game of the year, right? Mm-hmm. Which is usually when optimism is highest. Then you pass it on to in the midst of our lovely Saturday out, I bumped into and talked to a lot of fans, and the three words I heard the most, which I is not nice to hear, same old bath. And so this is, I think this is wearing on the fan base. If you look at the Facebook comments for the upcoming night game post on the Bath Rugby post, there are several of them saying, not waste my money. They have yeah. till halftime. Turn out the lights. Don't even bother turning them on. Mm-hmm. So that's not good. And then it's all actually brought in where they've just announced that students, there's now a student ticket option for £20. So all of this kind of looks to me as if things aren't going well and they're going to try to bolster getting people into the stands, which is not surprising. Losing usually doesn't have a great effect on the fan base and the desire to attend games.
Yeah, I will say that I go onto the supporters page a lot and read the comments. And for a first home game, I would say 90%, 95% of the comments were all bad. That's not a great start for your first game. I mean, they were bad. And people are cheesed off, and you're quite right. A lot of people, I mean, I could have predicted what the outcome would have been of comments when they put up about the Friday night game. I just knew that people were going to be straight and go, well, I'm not going to bother. Why waste the time, you know, turn up?
Yeah.
And that's quite shocking.
It's quite sad.
It is. It's sad. It's sad considering we've got a new coaching team and we're trying to be positive and go forward. But yeah, that's not good. So, I mean, we're going to talk about the Wasps game in a bit. So I'll leave that to what I'm going
to
say.
Before we get to the Wasps preview, because I think we're rolling here pretty well. Yeah, not too bad. Ben Spencer. In the 28th minute of the match, my heart broke. Because Ben Spencer, to me, is the best nine in the world. He's our club captain, and I consider him pretty much be the best player on the team. I know Will Muir actually got the award, but to me, Ben Spencer is the guy that makes that whole thing go. And 28th minute concussion, it was actually pretty scary if you watch the replay. It was not a hit from another player. It was actually Big Joe cocking a stick. It was his shoulder in an attempt to stop a player from scoring a try. That didn't work. The try was scored, and we lost Ben Spencer. Hodge, how bad of a loss is Ben Spencer?
Yeah, it's huge, especially when you've now, you're 2-0 and you've got to win your next game. The next game is a must win. We'll go on to that again when we get to it. But that is huge. He's out for 12 days.
At least 12 days. At least 12 days.
Are we going to talk about
you? If you want to talk about other injuries, go for it. I was just, Ben Spencer to me is the focal point in this conversation, because injuries is just now a reoccurring.
If you lose your captain, that's bad. So Lewis Schroeder's got to come in, so he's going to have a massive game on Friday.
Yeah.
Huge game. Well, again, we'll talk about Wasps in a minute. So Ben Spencer's going off HIA, he's out for 12 days. Our injury list is mounting up already. We must have 5-6 players now that can't play. And one of the key issues, which was mentioned when the new coaching team came in, the fitness team was to minimise injuries. Now, I know accidents and collisions are going to happen on the pitch, aren't they? But, you know, Yaka Kuitsa went off again. He's gone off every game now, injured. How many more injuries is he going to get before he's going to be sidelined for a long time?
Well,
And then we've got, what's our backup eight, big eight? I'm a little bit worried about that.
Well, Wesley White made his debut. He was actually the player I was most liking to see, but there really wasn't much to talk from any of the players. Ben Spencer is a huge loss. He's the captain, like you said. I consider him to make everything go. And he's such a steady head on the court, on the field, and such a good player. And then you go with, right, because then it's about, okay, it's not just Ben Spencer, right? Announced what it was, I don't know if it was 2 days before, or 3 days before, or a day before the match, but Obano's had knee surgery. There's no timetable on him. Underhill's 12 weeks on the shoulder.
Yeah.
Obviously, Kutsia, and the biggest thing about Kutsia, right, is Kutsia didn't just take a knock, right? Kutsia ended up writhing in pain down as halftime had gone, and he's laying there, and you can tell that it's, again, it's not just a knock, and we'll see him next week. You know, it's one of those things where now we have to have some kind of further examination, and then there's a timetable. Big Dave Atwood, right? He beautifully, I mean, he took that head-to-head like a champ, but it cost him a nice, or it earned him a nice fat scar above his eye, which if that guy plays on Friday, I'd be absolutely amazed and impressed. Yeah, he's also
every minute.
Well, also a little worried for him. But point is, he took a knock. So at this point now, the injuries are mounting and they're coming to me. For Ben Spencer now becomes the tip of the sword, the key player to me, the one player I probably would not choose to lose is Ben Spencer. And he's at least 12 days, which puts him eligible for the Irish match and this, who knows, concussions are a scary thing. You don't play around with them. If he misses the Irish match, I think Gloucester's after, Saracen's after that. So who knows when we see him again? Sometimes these things linger. So this is
don't forget Mark Gallagher. He's still on HIA.
Yeah.
Chris Colletti, he's still on. He's what? What come back about his
knee?
Is it knee?
I don't think.
Have they actually released the details?
I don't think any details have come on Colletti yet. So
again, I don't want to be all negative. So I still want to be positive, and still a shout out to Bath, the medical team, in terms of giving out details, although being they're rubbish and they're sad that they're injured, but thank you for doing that. That's much improved.
Well, yep. This brings us to a pivotal point in the season already. We are 2 weeks in, Hodge. We are about to face a Wasp team that is also, in my opinion, scrappy and scraping for their life, as they are 0-2. So Friday night at the Rec, 7:45, we will be there. Hopefully, minus some Q-busters. So
definitely only having more. 4 pints of Guinness if I'm drinking. I want to watch this game.
But Hodge, 0-2 Wasps, 0-2 Bath, Friday night. What are you seeing?
It's absolute must win. And if we lose this one and go 3-0, then the shit's going to hit the fan. Excuse my French, and there are any children watching.
But it will be...
For the record, I don't make the settings on the YouTube, I don't make it suitable for kids, so we're all fine. All right, swear away.
Cool. All right.
It's a fucking big match.
But it's a huge match, so obviously... It's a must-win game. If we go 3-0, then the alarm bells, 0-3, the alarm bells will be ringing, aren't they? But, I mean, at the end of the day, Wasps must be almost kind of purring at the fact that they can play Bath now. They're going to be thinking, this is our win. Yeah. They've just got to watch the game back and just see what Sale did. And, this is it. This is our win.
Yeah.
They've just got to watch the game back and just see what Sale did. And, this is it. This is our win.
Oh, yeah. Right. This to me felt... This feeling is getting weird again, where it feels like last season, where I think a lot of teams played us and went, right, we got this in the bag. We push them 40 minutes, we'll get over there, we'll get the win. Now, I don't think we're quitting in this set. Again, I don't think there's any quit in us left yet. But the scary thing is, we're now 0-2, with the possibility of going 0-3. And then you have to face the reality that we'll lose successive games at home, and then have to go to Irish.
Yeah.
And then I think it's back home against Gloucester, and then it's Saracens on the road. So you're looking at, after this, it's 2 of 3 on the road against proven rugby teams from last year. So that's a little scary. The only thing that fills me with a little bit of hope is, I believe his name is Lewis Schroeder. The backup 9 came over from Newcastle. I thought he was very good. So that fills me with some confidence that I'm not as worried as past seasons for our scrum half position. So I think he's going to be able to step in. Then it's just a matter of, what are we going to do differently, offensively and defensively, to get us over the hump? Because right now, Hodge, and I'm going to tell you right now, because I love me some stats. Right now...
You love the stats.
Exactly. Right now, and what was scary about last week, I told you this before the show, is last week's score of 37-20 was basically what we averaged last year. Last year, we scored about 18 points a game, and we gave up about 38 points a game. So last week's 37-20 is basically our sweet spot. That's our bread and butter, and has been for quite some time. We average, and this is how it goes, we average 2 tries a game. And 2 tries a game is not going to get it done. Not going to get it done at all. The scariest thing, are you ready for this? This is some scary stuff. You ready for this? I want you to tell me Bath Rugby's largest margin of victory in the last 18 months.
Oh, God. Well, it's going to be low. 5.
6.
Oh, well, not that far. I was all right.
6. 6 points is the amount we beat Northampton at the end of, not last season, the previous season. Hodge, double points here. What is the largest margin of victory last season?
Three.
5.
Oh, come
on. Right now, when we win, and this has been going on, it has been 18 months since we just put it on somebody, opened a can on them. 18 months since a double-digit victory. So last season, if we just go last season, we don't have a win this year. Last season, our margin of victory, 3.4 points. 3.4 points. So when we win a game, that is within, to me, the realm of maybe it could have gone the other way.
Well, if we're going to be sticking to the game plan that we think we're going to be getting from our coaches, I wouldn't expect any large scores coming very soon. I want to be proved wrong, obviously, but I can't see that happening.
Yeah, and this is the last scary stat I'm going to leave everyone with.
The statistician.
Yeah.
Is that a word?
Bath. 2/3 of the time when we lose. So 66% of our losses when we lose. Double digits.
Mm.
So when we lose 2/3 of the time, it really isn't very close. And if you were to look into the points of some of the losses, 64, 54, 20, 22, I'm talking, we have been blown out several times in the last 18 months, 2 years, that makes this game, I mean, we're not even having a preview for Wasps, really. Wasps got spanked by Bristol last week, 23-8. In reality, this may be a very close matchup.
Yeah.
Which is, again, somewhat concerning, and I don't know about you. Again, we always do the show before the team sheets come out, but what I can tell you is, right now, through 2 games, I'm worried. We are not... 2 tries is not going to get it done. No. 18 to 20 points is not going to get it done. It almost doesn't matter who's playing, right? So you have this notion of like, oh, we want these individual matchups. Doesn't matter if nothing equates to points or stopping points.
And remember as well that our target is to concede no more than 2 tries.
Oof.
That was the target set by the coaches.
And yet Sale just walked away with a bonus point try with 14 men.
Team selection is going to be interesting. I'd go with Bailey at 10. I think we just need to get the lad in and get a bit of flair. But again, it's going to come down to what players are available. I mean, are you going to put Wesley White in at 7 again? If Miles Reed is fit, for me, he goes in. Straight in.
So again, my biggest thing is I don't know if the player selection is going to make the biggest impact in here. I wonder if, again, this is going to take more time than we want. I think a lot of Bath fans basically went, the players are great, right? The ingredients are great. We just need a great chef. And we went, right, we got the chef, right? And we have these ingredients. And it just hasn't, through 2 weeks, amounted really to anything. I said this again. We are now worse off now at this point through 2 weeks than we were last year. So this game, we said this is a massive game. And if it's 0-3, the fan base to me is going to be on fire, really angry. I'd be interested to see about what the attendance is, if your attendance stat of it rising in October. But until we know the team sheets, we can't really guess. But that might be more for you, because I believe something fundamentally is just not clicking.
Well, hold on, team. We're in for a rough ride. But it is a case of, starting from scratch, as JVD came in and said. Every player is on 0.
That's true.
So now he's going to be looking at me going, right, he's not going to be in my plans, or he's not going to be in my plans. I want to bring this person in. I want to bring that person in. Just got a guy down. Just put your balls to the wall and just get the W.
All right, guys, that's going to do it for us.
Hold on,
we'll come back to that after the thing. Do we?
Yes.
Well, hold on. So I'm going to end it there because that's 30 minutes or so. So we're going to cap that at the show. Then wait.
Okay, I know. Then, I see where you're going. Can I just say one more thing before we go?
Yeah, go for it.
I just like to put out a massive shout to all the Worcester players and the staff up there. Just huge congratulations, you guys. You put a hell of a fight up against Exeter.
Yeah.
So fair play for you to play. And also, you're going to be a tough team to beat. I don't want to come to... I don't have to go to you at the moment because you'll beat us, quite frankly. So keep it going, guys. You're doing an amazing, amazing job. And it's good to still have you here. Well,
they're actually one of our double-digit defeats last year.
Brilliant. That's my case, then.
That's enough.
See you later.
Yeah.
I said the king's in the building. Tell me how you feeling. Yeah, I said the king's in the building. Tell me how you feeling. Yeah. Now I'm about to show them how to make it in America. She's a ugly Betty, all America Ferreira, huh? Am I speaking clear enough? AC Dub, turn me up. I be chasing green like I'm running after turnip trucks. Who am I? Think you know. Bakers, man, I get that dough. All I see is Charlie Sheen, so I'm on my Emilio. Estevez, Esteban, they don't be what I be on. Every track I poop up on, I turn it into Grey Poupon. Follow me, hit the stage, turn this to a panty raid. Tough back to follow like a band without a Twitter page. Guess that means I'm going in. Other rappers sitting wait. Basically, I'm getting money. You just watch the getaway. Jesse James, all the same. But I gotta watch my back. When you make it to the top, they look like Casey Affleck. Oh, you wanna beef with me, but really, I don't know you. Tell these dog funnies that I keep that killer tone. Now put your hands to the ceiling. Oh, what a feeling. Got this place rocking like Elvis in the building. About to make a killing. Going for a million. Keep this place rocking like Elvis in the building. Men, women, and children. Tell me how you feeling. Got this place rocking like Elvis in the building. About to make a killing. Going for a million. Keep this place rocking like Elvis in the building. Starting arcade fire every time I spit that yoga flame. Don't act like you don't know the name. It's similar to Novocaine. So propane, so profound. You ain't know I shut it down. Must be Stephen King, it cause all I see's a bunch of clowns. Round and round and round we go. Will it stop? I'll never know. Let me see you do-si-do. Real recognize real do-si-do. Julie G and Bossa Nova. Yes, we the best. N-O-B to the O-T-S. Always wanting nothing less. I'm sick and fly, you notice that. So I got flights and coasts to catch. Don't even blow your noses yet, cause you are not exposed to this. You might catch me boast a bit, but can I claim the coldest yet? Only one way to find out. Cul-de-sac. See, I be on my data rock. I'm birthing all these Basquiats. Reason that that bastard's hot. I know they wanna take my spot. Nothing like the usual. Think outside the cubicle. Just a band of horses catches drinking at your funeral. Now put your hands to the ceiling. Oh, what a feeling. Got this place rocking like Elvis in the building. About to make a killing. Going for a million. This place rocking like Elvis in the building. Men, women, and children, tell me how you feeling. Got this place rocking like Elvis in the building. About to make a killing, going for a million. Keep this place rocking like I said the king's in the building. Tell me how you feeling. Yeah, I said the king's in the building.